It's academic and it's theater, the place where they both meet.
We have the audience and participants for each other.
Intellectual practice is the start of practice as well. Come on. Everybody, please.
Samples of women.
Sharing what it is that you do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore that love anymore.
Welcome all around the world. You can come and see and talk about.
It starts out a little thing, you like a bit, you have to be completely open.
Theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's just what should be done.
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death, I've already changed.
The survival of theater as an art form depends on that.
But there's room for it all. There's room for it all.
So thank you, everybody, for coming here to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center at the Graduate Center, CUNY. And this is the first day of the great Penbold Voices International Playwrights Festival. It's a program dear and very, very important to our heart. We bridge here academia and professional theater, international and American theater. My name is Frank Henschke. I'm the director of the center. And I think there's not enough that goes back and forth between the countries or across the ocean. Someone said it's like red wine in the old sailed boats, you never know if it arrives in good shape. But I think we all have to do a better job to reach out and to listen, and the Blay Company, with whom we collaborate for this reading, is one of the great companies in the Americas to really dedicate work and their energy and lifetime to this, and we are collaborating with them for the reading of the Stefano Massini's Intractable Woman, a great play about a great, great journalist who was got killed. We actually held for her in collaboration with Penn commemoration, celebrating her life and work. We also would like to thank Valeria from the Italian Playwrights Project, who brought Stefano Massini, the playwright, here first. We did a reading with him on the Lehman Brothers, two German, I think, Orthodox Jewish brothers who left in the 1860s, came to America, and then created the Lehman Brothers, as we know them, until the 50s or 60s. They were a great company led by the family. Then it changed, the corporation took over, and that play actually is now being done by Sam Mendes in the National Theatre in London. So this playwright who we hear tonight really is one of the great masters of his field. So I think we are in for a very interesting reading. I also think this is important to the mission of Penn itself, the freedom to write. Penn is one of the great organizations in the world anyway, but especially for the freedom to write. They do work with writers in prison, get them actually really out of prison, and hand out one of the most significant literary awards. And I really encourage you also to check out the Festival of Penn World Voices. Over, I think, 60 or 70 writers are right now in the city of New York, and it's one of the reasons why New York City is such a great town because of things that happened, like the Penn World Voices. And we are extremely honored that we, for over 10 years now, collaborate and with Penn on the festival. So the play reading will be about, minute-wise, how long? 70 minutes, and then afterwards we will hear in the space a little discussion with the artist and with Paula and translator and others. And then you can join us. There's an archive bar around where some of the artists, some of the writers will be. It's called the archive, as mentioned in the program. If you want to fill out our little audience question, that would be great. You can keep the pencil as a reward. And if that is a stimulation, please do so. And so we know a little bit better how good we can do to reach people. Because a lot of people say, I wish I would have known earlier what the Siegel Center does. And we maybe don't do the best job in the world in the outreach. So we want to learn how to do that better. If you have a cell phone, please do take it out now, and I'll do the same and check that it's off and mute. If mine is, so it doesn't ring, please really give it another look. And it never rings in our readings, and it would be a shame. It's the first time ever tonight. So again, thank you so much. And Intractable Woman by Stefano Massini. And here we go.
Thank you. could start in many ways. With a name, for instance, Vladislav Surkov. This gentleman works in the office of the Russian president. They trust him at the Kremlin.
And they listen to him.
In 2005, Surkov writes in an internal circular that, quote, enemies of the state are divided into two categories, the kind that you can re-educate and the intractable.
Discussion is not possible with the second kind, and this makes re-education impossible.
The state requires us to clear our territories of these intractables.
Morning of August 5th, Chronicle of Another Day, in Kirchilaj, Chechnya. There's a strange dust in the air. The square is small, full of people, mostly women, in the middle of a mix of earth and sand. Gray houses, not white. You'd expect those houses to be white, or maybe a sandy color. In Asia, houses are always thought to be sand-colored. Instead, there they are, gray cement, dirty, almost black. Doesn't seem like Asia, and yet it is Asia. Third millennium Asia. For some reason, I find myself passing by a square like all the others, a place like all the others. They're all alike here. White sky, dusty air. Then, like an iron and steel giant, the pipeline. Across the entire village. Actually, it's almost like the village emerged from the pipeline or sprouted up around it, like those reddish mushrooms around here that sometimes attach themselves to tree trunks at night. They cling all the way around as if they want to steal the space for themselves. The pipeline crosses all of Chechnya from top to bottom, enormous, majestic, writ large. No one knows where it begins, no one knows where it ends. From the moment to the next, it seems about to collapse, and yet it remains standing. So far, it's there. Despite rust, despite crumbling, despite the weight. Anyway, the pipeline crosses Kirchilaj Square. There's a crowd in the square, a waiting crowd. Before I can ask myself what's stirring clouds of dust, a truck appears. Two men step down. The crowd draws together. I move closer to the women. I have a scarf around my face so I can be taken for one of them. A basin comes out through the window. And from the basin, the two guys take out a kind of tattered ball, a red ball. They let it drain onto the ground. It's a head, a human head hanging on a hook. They stick it there on the pipe of the pipeline, on the iron, not moving, like those backpacks that hang on hooks outside the shops on display in plain sight. A head up there. It doesn't care that the pipeline behind its back rushes away fast toward the east. It does not move. And now it drips, slowly, precisely. It drips, it drips, it drips. On the ground below in the dusk, there's a sort of lake, a red lake. And the head continues to pour its red drops into the lake, one after the other, slowly, precisely, slowly, precisely. The two policemen stand in front on guard. People pass by and look, and the hanging head drips, slowly, precisely. Whose head is it? What happened? A few nights before, between the 27th and the 28th of July, two Chechen guerrillas fell in an ambush. The police who report to Moscow laid the trap just at steps outside the village. One Chechen was captured, the other killed, to set an example for the whole village. The policemen remove the head and hang it from the pipeline in the middle of the village to drip into the square, while the other cops write up reports. It often happens here. The cops decapitate the guerrillas and use the head as a trophy. In half a day, they'll take it down from up there, reattach it to the body with iron thread as the law requires. At that point, it will have stopped dripping.
There are those who say that places in the world are a little like their rivers, that the spirit of the people, the history of the people, flows like the waters of their rivers. The Tarik River is turbulent. It rocks, cascades, violence. Freezing cold water, born from ice, it flows 600 kilometers first to North Russia, then east. It gallops, dives, making a gigantic swamp before hurling itself into the Caspian Sea. The Terek River, a serpent of water wedged tightly between the mountains of the Caucasus and two seas, the Caspian on the right, the Black Sea on the left, like a parched handful of earth flung between two pools of water. And the people make war for centuries for power over that earth. So many nations you lose count. Ossetia, Ingushetia, Dagestan, Balakaria, Circassia, Adigesia, Georgia, Armenia, Azerbaijan, and then finally Turkey. And right in the middle of that handful of earth, tied up, trapped, suffocated, microscopic, Chechnya. Holding on there on the banks of the Terek, restless land, Chechnya, like its river, rebellious land, not only now but for centuries. It doesn't recognize masters. It doesn't recognize authority, not only now but for centuries. Proud land, hostile, like the horses from here that can't be broken. Insolent land, Chechnya, disobedient, dangerous, not only now but for centuries. The common greeting on the street, even today, is not good day or good evening, or God bless you, but I wish you liberty. Liberty, something they've never had. From the 18th century to today, Russia has been at war with Chechnya to prove to herself that she controls the empire. From the 18th century to today, Chechnya doesn't ask for freedom. Chechnya seizes it, it revolts. Revolutions, bombs, attacks. This is Chechnya to the Russians, a land of rebels to be tamed through bloodshed. This is Russia for the Chechens, a country of masters to be hunted down, to be bled dry. Tsar Nicholas I persecuted them for 40 years. Stalin had them deported en masse. In 3 days, the entire Chechen population was moved to Kazakhstan, territorial zoning, Soviet style. Ethnic redistribution, men, women, elderly, children, they returned home only 13 years later, 1957. In the last 10 years, right up to today, the war is continuous. The war to save Russia from the southern Arabs. In Russia, the peoples of the Caucasus are called the Black Asses. They call it the long war against the Chernozemli. The only opposing voices have been the soldiers' mothers. They hold protests, march in squares. They don't want their sons off the front. Solution, starting tomorrow, only orphans can enlist. At least then, there's no protest. Russia ships mercenary troops to Chechnya on contract. I pay you, you fight. Those who want to enlist are ex-cons, criminals, gangs of unemployed, and ultra-right wingers who typically say, I get off when I kill the Chernozemli. They're called the Chechen Forest Cleaning Unit. And they clean all right. Actually, they cleanse, which is different.
I convince a boy in the Russian unit to talk to me. I meet him in a half-empty barracks on the periphery of Vilni. Only a few have remained in the garrison here. The others have been moved into the mountains. His camouflage uniform is too big for him. It gives him shoulder pads. I don't tell him, but it's a little funny. What's your name?
Sasha.
Okay, Sasha. Sasha Grigdaev. But don't write that down. Can I ask how old you are? 19. How long have you been in Chechnya?
7 months.
Is this what you chose, or did they send you here?
I chose it. Nobody forced me.
All right, can you tell me why a 19-year-old boy decides to come to Chechnya?
They pay me.
That's why? There was no work. I starved for a year and a half.
And so you enlisted.
In those days,
Word was the army was looking for orphans to go to Chechnya for pretty good pay. If I had to, I'd re-enlist right away. Sasha, how many people have you killed since you've been in Chechnya? I'm within regulation. What do you mean, within regulation? By the numbers. What numbers? Each of us has to kill 3 or 4 a day. A day. At least 3 or 4. Can you do it? There are techniques. For example, the human bundle. What would that be? You go into a village, you take 10 people, tie them up, tight, with rope, toss a grenade in the middle, blow them up, boom. Do you have a cigarette? Have you done it yet? What? This human bundle, boom. 3 times. Are you proud of it? They do it to us, we do it to them first, so. So what? I mean, it's not like they're human, they're just Chechens. So, do you have a cigarette? I look at this young boy in front of me. He could be my son, after all. The question that comes to mind is, what's the cause, the reason? Then I think that his life, his 19 years, is a microcosm of Russia's recent history. My story, our story, in 5 stages. In 1986, a young boy was born in 1986. The days of Gorbachev talking about liberty, transparency, 1986, perestroika, glasnost, new life. You talk about it out loud, you think about it, everything is changing. Newspapers start asking, what crap is the KGB hiding? 1991, the boy is 5 years old. He goes to school. He sees the end of the Soviet Union. He hears so many speeches, the West, democracy, desires, dreams, hopes, all looking to the future. If you want to offend somebody, you call them KGB face, which means shit face. 1996, now he's 10 years old. The great disappointment, hunger in Russia, stores closed, thieves everywhere, crazy prices. On the streets of Moscow, millionaires in Rolls Royces and crowds in tatters. The president of Russia is Boris Yeltsin, hopeless drunk. At state funerals on live TV, he whistles and laughs. Things go backward. Somebody says, at least the KGB worked. It maintained order, order that doesn't exist anymore. 2001, the boy is 15. Russia is worse than the Wild West. They kill you on the street for a single ruble. Nobody works. Gangs of thugs, attacks, bombs, buildings, subways, blown up. The squares full of processions, neo-Nazis, neo-Leninists, neo-Stalinists, neo-Tsarists, hyper-extra-ultra-nationalists waving banners crying, if only the KGB still existed. And in fact, an ex-colonel of the Secret Service is nominated and named president. A patriotic war is declared on Chechnya. It is said to be a triumph. Here's to the president. Here's to Russia. We're great again. 2005, today, the boy is 19. He devotes himself to human bundles. And he's content. But if you ask him, what do you want to do with your life? Right now, I'm at war. And when it ends, I hope it doesn't.
Aren't you afraid to be in Grozny? People die there. Everybody thinks the problem with being in Grozny is fear. Fear of death, being blown up, getting yourself killed, finding a bullet in your head. The truth is, that's the least of it. You get used to the idea of death. After a while, you don't even think about it. You take it for granted, even. But you know it can happen, but you forget about it. A strange thought comes into your head, that you're playing with death. You're challenging. Your step passed so close, you graze it, you know it's there, close by, but you keep going. I mean, it's so present, you don't mind it anymore. No, the real problem with my months in Grozny is something else. The problem is that everything's a problem, constantly, from the moment you wake up in the morning till you close your eyes at night. Here's a typical journalist day in Grozny. Here's a list of a journalist's problems in Grozny. 7 a.m., you wake up. First problem, okay? The aqueduct was blown up, there's no water. You turn on a tap, nothing. Bottled water is expensive. And even if you could pay for it, you can't find it. The only water in Grozny belongs to the army. They bring it in from Russia in tankers. In fact, an extremely long line extends from their camps. They make you pay on the black market for a 3-minute shower timed to the second. 8 a.m., breakfast. Second problem, you have nothing to eat. Because you have to eat something, because for 8 months a year it's freezing cold, so if you don't eat, you'll pass out. That happened to me, by the way. So you try to solve the problem by searching for provisions. Warning, not what you like, which would be a luxury. No, I mean whatever's edible, like half a tin of meat, say. Powdered milk, anchovies, bran flakes, yes, the diet food. I promise you, the stomach cramps are that painful. Otherwise, if you want to eat, the only food in Grozny belongs to the army. They bring it in from Russia in vans. In fact, an extremely long line extends from their camp. They make you pay on the black market for one packet with one slice of bread in it. Sometimes I swear I've gone there myself. 10 a.m. You get to work. You have to write an article. Third problem. There's no electricity. Or better yet, it comes and goes. There are attacks at stations. The internet's unreliable, so you write it by hand on scraps of paper. Then you call it in from a phone booth. Clearly, because there's no phone reception, cell phone reception, there's only about a dozen phone booths left standing in the whole city center. The only telephones in Grozny belong to the army. And if you pay, then maybe, but I've never tried that. 1 a.m., you go around to get interviews and all that. Fourth problem, getting around. The streets are half blown up. There are craters, chasms, pits. You can only get around with an SUV. The army has some, but they hang on to them tightly. So I start my hunt for a vehicle. I prick up my ears. You said you were going out of town. Can I tag along? That covers the trip there and the return, a bike trip. 3, 4, 5 p.m. You have meetings with people, write notes, observe. Fifth problem, roadblocks. You get the basic idea. I get the basic idea, which is according to the Russian army, people in Grozny should never go. According to them, the city should live closed up, stopped up, locked up. The moment you step out onto the street, you're in the wrong. They stop you between 5-10 times a day. They ask you for documents, check documents, various taunts, jokes, double entendres. I put up with them. Then the question, was it absolutely necessary for you to circulate? What this means precisely is that moving around is practically a crime. It infuriates me. I can't stand it. Sometimes I'm able to stay quiet. I nod, pretend I have a headache. Other times, unfortunately, I can't do it. And I reply, what about you? Is it absolutely necessary for you to breathe? For the record, I calculated that 2 hours a day go by at roadblocks. 6 p.m., it's starting to get dark. Sixth problem, the curfew. From here on, problems triple. Not only because of roadblocks, not only because you have to get back home, God knows how, there are other problems that come with darkness and growth. Chechen criminal gangs. They lurk in dark corners. One streetlight in 10 actually works. And they take everything you have, including the buttons on your gloves. If you don't come across any thugs, you can always hope for drunks. They buy vodka from the army. Or drug addicts, they buy opium from the Chechens. But as a last resort, there's the ever-popular wild card, packs of stray dogs. Tear a few dozen people a month to pieces here in the city. 10 p.m. Time to sleep. Seventh problem, which is indeed sleeping. There are 5, 6, 7 explosions a night. At each explosion, you wake up, you ask yourself, is my building collapsing? You look at the ceiling, it's not collapsing. You see the floor, it's not collapsing. You touch it, it's not collapsing. You tell yourself, it's over, you go back to sleep, or at least you try to, until the next one. Voila, end of days, end of problems. Last year, I was invited to a conference abroad. After 3 straight months in Grozny, I went to France. I arrive at a hotel. I arrive at night, go to my hotel, wake up the next morning with a strange feeling. I have slept without waking, without explosions. I get up, go to the bathroom, stare fearfully at the tap, abruptly turn it on, and incredibly, a roar of water, and hot at that, I let it run. Looking at it, and I feel like laughing, but not a little, like a lot, like crazy. I don't know if I'm laughing or crying, I just know that I stand there looking at the water, listening to the water, gazing at the water like an idiot.
Notice there are more flies here in the hospital than in a goat farm?
Hospital number 9 in Grozny, the capital city. I'm here to interview the head doctor. He's young. His name is Sultan Kajev. He has a stiff, paralyzed leg. Ask him what happened.
I was lucky I only lost the leg. It's a miracle I'm alive.
Souvenir of a landmine?
Oh, no. I was in my car at an intersection. A military armored car swooped in out of nowhere, speeding like crazy in the middle of the city. I was thrown out. The car was totaled. It was driven by a Russian soldier, 20 years old, drunk.
Was there an investigation?
They gave him a medal.
Naturally. Is this the only hospital?
The only one left standing.
Barely.
But it's still standing. If you go around the wards here and there, you'll find a wall missing. You can see it from the outside, thanks to a few mortar shells.
From the army?
From whoever. You never know who's shooting anymore in Grozny. You know they shoot. That's all.
There are cots everywhere.
Nowadays, they take a bench, throw a tablecloth over it, and it's a bed. In triage, we perform operations on wooden boards.
Dr. Kajev, how many wounded end up in this ward?
Around 300 in the last few months.
People pour in continually.
One without an arm, one with a face, his face cut open, souvenir of a landmine.
I see women, mostly.
The majority are women. They come from towns, villages. There are mixed gangs of Russian military and Chechen guerrillas. They have contests to see who can rape the most women in one night.
And the police don't stop them?
Rape is legal here. If you assault a woman, no one will do anything.
And Colonel Budanov's armored regiment, they bring in a truck full of girls every night.
The next morning, they end up here. Provided the guys don't have a little fun first and beat them to death.
And sooner or later, they go back home?
No, according to Chechen tradition, when a woman has been raped, she is no longer worthy of her husband.
They're abandoned?
Yes, even by their families. They become polluted.
What happens to them?
Nothing.
They stay here, completely destitute?
All of Chechnya is like that, in limbo. The people don't exist. We're bodies with nothing inside them. We're nobody.
A land of nobodies.
A land of nobodies.
Sometimes I think it doesn't take much to make sense of Chechnya. You just have to look at who's in charge. His name, Ramzan Kadyrov, age 30. Today, he's prime minister of Chechnya. His face is on all the posters, on all the walls, in all the streets of Grozny. I ask you, how can a man of 30 be prime minister? In the end, the story is simple. Ramzan's father was Ahmed Kadyrov, president of Chechnya. Fine, moving on. Just after he turned 20, Ramzan is named the head of Chechen Presidential Secret Service. In 3 years, he accumulates countless accusations of rape violence. Fine, moving on. When he's 25, Ramzan creates an army. Oh yes, even this can be done in Chechnya. The son of the president can create his own army, a personal army. They're paid out of state funds, and Russia supports it. There are 3,000 men in Khazarov's junior army. It goes by the name of its boss. The troops call themselves Khazarovsti. Human Rights Watch claims that Ramzan Kadyrov's personal army is responsible for 70% of all torture in Chechnya. Fine, moving on. Ramzan Kadyrov remains head of Secret Service until May 9, 2004. That day, there's a parade in Grozny Stadium to commemorate the Russian victory of the Second World War. The president, Ramzan's father, is seated in the reviewing stand, then the kicker. A huge explosion blows up the entire presidential committee. Young Ramzan is not at the stadium, so he survives. Talk about luck. As a gesture of solidarity, the Russians give Ramzan the second highest position in the state, deputy prime minister. Not bad. Ramzan's only 28 years old, and he's already deputy prime minister. But that's not enough for him. He says publicly more than once, I'd like to have Prime Minister Sergei Abramov's job. And his dream comes true, because December 2005, Abramov dies in a car accident. To this day, no one knows what caused the accident, which happened in Moscow. But the fact is that Ramzan automatically becomes prime minister. Fine, moving on. Ramzan Kadyrov's government governs Chechnya today with Russia's full support. His is a reign of terror that relies on paramilitary troops. In 10 years, they have exterminated a quarter of the original population. Shortly after he's named prime minister, Anna Politkovskaya interviews Ramzan Kadyrov for her newspaper. The answers are published verbatim, and Kadyrov gave them, without changing a comma. Normally, politicians complain when interviews do not print what they actually said, but in this case, it was the opposite. Ramzan Kadyrov's reaction the day after publication: I find the behavior of this journalist unacceptable. Doesn't she know it's the interviewer's job to make the interviewee look good? What right did she have to publish my responses exactly as I gave them? Clearly, this woman doesn't want to be one of us.
He tells me to enter. Inside the tank, it's almost completely dark. Outside, it's been pouring since this morning. I can hear rain and hail beating on the green armored plate. It's the first time that a high-ranking Russian official in Chechnya has agreed to meet me. His name is Alexei. I cannot reveal his last name. He's a colonel in command of an airborne unit. We're in Katuni, a ghostly place full of landfill sites. Around us, I count dozens of pits. Huge craters dug into the ground, deep, half full of garbage. They empty trash cans into them. Here, there's no other way to deal with waste. It sits there, thrown away. The rain seeping into the muck has made dark pools of slime. Outside, the stench is overwhelming. It claws at your throat. At least inside the tank, you can breathe. The colonel is sitting between the knobs and controls, white hair, wrinkles that cut deep. On his chest, a medal of valor. He adjusts it constantly. Dark glasses. I don't know why he wears them, but there you are. He stares at me. As if I were somehow surprising. Awkward silence. Then, I get it.
Thought you'd be a man.
A woman's no good.
Me, I got no problem. No good for you, I mean.
In what sense?
What's a journalist in a skirt doing down here with us?
Taking a look around.
Your old man's okay with that?
I'll ask the questions if you don't mind.
First, right, they gotta pay us more to be in Chechnya.
Meaning?
I served 40 years, I gotta be in this shit now. I wanna at least make some money.
Is it true that the Russian army loots villages with Chechen gangs?
I don't think so.
But you don't deny it.
Wouldn't happen if they paid us more.
Can you confirm that your soldiers also drink and take drugs?
The odd time.
And you punish them?
If morale is low, what are they supposed to do? I told you. All you gotta do is pay them.
And the assaults, the rapes, can you confirm them?
Newspapers exaggerate that.
How?
Our boys are young, far from home, every so often they have a little fun.
That's all.
Look, they're bastard people, the Chechens. The women are all into it at first, and they go around crying rape. They lie. They're like that.
It's been documented.
Made up. Journalists like you write lies.
What should I write?
That we're fighting for the motherland and against enemies of the people and traitors.
I'll write that you're heroes.
Right where you are. I know how rough it is here. The whole thing is on our shoulders.
Give me an example.
You see the landfill out there? I'm talking about dumping Chechens in with the trash.
What does that mean?
Got a prison. Camps for the prisoners. So we throw them in there.
Into the pits with the garbage?
You can get a lot in there. You can pack them in tight.
Why did you tell me that?
Because if I gotta be the garbage man, they gotta pay me more. Right back.
A radio's on. Commercial jingles in the next room, or maybe the one after. I don't know. Anyway, it's on. I'm seated. On what, a chair? I haven't noticed. Maybe a crate. Wood? Doesn't seem like it. It's cardboard. What's inside? I have no idea. The drops of sweat are so large, you could count them. Yes, you could count them. On your neck, behind your ear, in your hair. 1, 2, 3, 20, 30, 50. They are all around. How many of them? 3, 4. There's another one as well, but he comes and goes. The barrel of a rifle pointed at my neck for how long now? An hour? Maybe more? Maybe less. But it seems like a century. So journalists, you don't want to tell us who you talk to? The jingle on the radio plays on. I hear a sudden noise on my right. I turn my head. A hand grabs my hair and pulls upward while a fist smashes my nose. I end up on the ground. I crawl, face in the dirt. They kick me in the chest. And both of them take my arms and drag me outside into the courtyard. From here, the jingles can't be heard. They tie me to something. I feel the iron cold against my back. A mortar, I think. He gets into my face. Now we are going to blow you to bits. What's going on, journalists? Not talking anymore? I don't talk, in fact. I don't make a sound. Not a word, not a tear, not a complaint, no cry. I am no longer me. I can't even move a finger. It's not part of me anymore. Now I hear the jingle has started up again. The door opens, somebody enters, running, says something into the ear of the other one, points at me, they stare at me, then, the minister has saved your ass, journalists. I don't react. It has nothing to do with me. They untie me, moving on. There's a helicopter leaving. I don't move my legs, they throw me inside. I lay there, stretched out for the whole flight. The pilots laugh, dirty jokes. Next to me, another body. I explore with my fingers. It doesn't move. I turn my head, which takes a huge effort. It's a corpse, still warm.
Open letter published in the Sakhalin newspaper from the soldiers of the 68th Russian Army Corps in Chechnya.
Letter of reply published in the Sakhalin newspaper from Anna Politkovskaya.
March 23rd, 2001. To the hardly reputable journalist, Anna Politkovskaya.
April 13th, 2001. To the nameless staff officers of the 68th Russian Army Corps.
Dear madam, you are not the first to offend the Russian Army Armed Forces, and you will not be the last. We have felt the need to write to you despite our contempt, not to respond to your mudslinging, but because of its impact. That you are widely considered a great reporter offends us.
Gentlemen, you know who I am. First name and last name, because I don't hide behind anonymity. And I don't walk around Chechnya with a black balaclava over my face the way Russian troops do, for reasons we are not privy to.
You make wild accusations over your arrest at a roadblock last February. Fine. It's possible that you were treated harshly, maybe even violently.
You accuse me of a smear campaign. I limit myself to reporting. If I see the public taxes are financing violence and torture, I have a duty to report it.
If you wanted to be treated with kid gloves, you shouldn't have come to Chechnya. If you really were a great journalist, you'd know that war has its rules. And whoever breaks them can't come crying about it after the fact, the way you do in your articles. You shouldn't have come down here to slander those who risk their lives so your little house in Moscow doesn't blow up.
You write that you are risking your lives for Russia. I have asked the army to escort me into the danger zones, and none of you has ever taken me up on it. Instead, I have seen your men loot post offices and send money to Moscow inside the coffins of dead soldiers.
In accusing us, you side with our opposition. And so you, dear lady, are our enemy. Please know that we are merciless with our enemies, and we will continue to be out of patriotic duty.
You write that I, too, am an enemy, and for that you threaten me, even from the pages of a newspaper. My reply is that it's true. I am an enemy of an army of criminals scavenged from jails and gutters of Moscow. I am an enemy of those who rape, loot, and steal.
Not wanting to sign this personally, we are, for your information, a group of staff officers.
If you are really proud of what you do, if you are convinced you're in the right, wonderful. Take off your balaclavas, abandon your anonymity, dare to look me in the eye and tell me I'm wrong. Yours truly, Anna Polakovskaya.
Sofa at home, not in Chechnya, no, my place in Moscow. TV remote, channel surfing, distracted, ads, news, quiz shows, sports, nothing grabs me, channel surfing, distracted, then I stop. Channel 1 on the public network, state television, Russian television, 8 p.m. primetime, all over Russia and beyond. At this moment, there are millions of screens in millions of homes tuning in. The new drama series is airing, titled The Just War. The setting is today in Chechnya. I don't change the channel. I'm interested. The protagonist, a group of Russian soldiers, all young and handsome, each one gets a letter. You are leaving for Chechnya, and nobody's pissed off. They're actually happy. They say things like, I will leave everything to defend our homeland. There's a father who's saluting his son, leaving for the front. He says to him, in my time, I fought Hitler. Now it's your turn. Tears, emotion. I notice that every time there are Russian troops on the screen, violin music swells in the background. They don't drink. They don't curse. They're honest, loyal. They call each other friend. They help each other. They sacrifice for each other. They write letters home, their teeth chattering in the cold. When one of the boys is hurt by a landmine, a chorus of soprano voices is heard, the fall of a hero. On the other side are the bad guys, which would be the Chechens. They've chosen ugly, disfigured actors with visible scars, bandages. One is missing an eye, one has no teeth. Another, the boss, wears a turban with a serpent on it. He limps, they call him the cripple. I notice that the Russian characters all have beautiful names. These Chechens don't have given names, only nicknames. Nicknames like the beast, the hawk, rat face. There isn't a single scene where Chechens don't swear. They steal, they take drugs, they betray each other. One kills his wife, another sells his children. They plan attacks on Moscow, they laugh about it, they tell jokes like, we'll kill all the Russian scum. When one of them is killed off, the sky opens and a ray of sunlight escapes. In a scene in the first episode, they show a mosque in Grozny, a dark, dank place like the ogre's cave in Russian folktales. Nobody enters without a dagger in hand. But the best character is a girl, a Chechen girl, strangely enough. She has a name, Rukia. This girl is with an ugly, horrible Chechen who beats her every day. But look, now she's in love with Sasha, a Russian soldier. He saves her. He takes her to the Russian barracks, where all the officials tell her, "You are safe here." And she starts crying and says, "May Allah bless you." After the final credits roll, writing fills the screen, moving upward slowly. This is a true story. All over Russia and beyond, at that moment, on millions of screens, in millions of homes, this is a true story. City is white, sky is white, it's snowing for months in Grozny, continuously. There's never been a winter like this one. Ice, sleet, like a vice.
Ruins covered with snow, buildings gutted, torn open, deserted. Iron skeletons, reinforced concrete, glass. 15 degrees below zero, refrigerated ruins. You come upon even this in Grozny.
On some walls, all snowy white, writing jumps out. Blood red, in fresh varnish. Surrender, Russians, we have you surrounded. You come upon even this in Grozny.
An afternoon, like so many others, in a freezing winter, 4 days till New Year's. At the time, I don't know this date will become famous. The biggest attack in the last 10 years.
Chechens are going to blow up other Chechens, their own kind. Sometimes it's said, like animals, but animals don't kill their own kind this way.
A truck packed with explosive, a kamikaze crashes into a wall of the legislature. Number of dead, incalculable.
If you haven't seen an attack with your own eyes, keep your mouth shut because you don't know anything. If you think blood on the ground is red, keep your mouth shut because you don't know that it's brown, almost black.
If you think a corpse is impressive, keep your mouth shut because you don't know about the ones who crawl, half dead, holding their own limbs.
The explosion shakes the walls. It's not the usual explosion or mortar attack, no. This time it's something else. That's what I think, and that's what I see in the eyes of those around me. Time stands still. Stop. Silence. First, the deafening bang, now, silence. Time stands still for a second, then starts up again.
Smoke invades the street, but not gradually, no, immediately.
And, as if from nowhere, like an echo, sound you don't recognize. I don't recognize it. Strangled. I'm an animalistic, deep. I realize later it's the screams of those who were there. Excited to run. I want to see. Around the corner, I run.
There's a crowd going the other way.
I run.
Crying, screaming, get away.
I run.
In the opposite direction, get away.
I run.
Dirty, dusty, gray faces getting away.
I run.
Screaming, bumping into me. They don't even see me.
I run.
The smoke in the air fills my throat.
I run.
And my heart pounds, 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 pounds in my chest.
I run.
Exhausted, out of breath.
I run.
My eyes can't fight the smoke either. They're burning.
I run.
They're burning like crazy.
I run.
I see flames now. So high.
I run.
Behind me, sirens are coming.
I run.
I slip, I get up. The snow is fresh.
I run.
There seems to be a fog in the air.
I run.
It's not fog. It's smoke, ashes, dust.
I run.
It's almost there.
I run.
I lift my eyes.
I run.
I stop. Blood. Snow. Blood. Snow. Blood. Snow.
There's fire everywhere. At my feet, on the ice.
Burning vans. Cars tipped over. Paper, folded, shredded clothes, uniforms, skirts, wooden hats, scarves, tatters, gloves, tires, carpets,
pieces of
wall, plaster, glass, chippings, iron, broken wood.
One human head, tiles, knobs.
A steering wheel, a car seat, a radio, a leg, taxi meters, torn signs, an arm, a hand.
Flags on their flagpoles, plastic bags, puke, shit, kerosene, gas, billboards.
Family photos, two dead dogs, wheelbarrows, bottles, drawers, one child.
Front headlights, broken tubes, electrical wires, fire extinguishers, hair, burning embers,
snow, blood.
You come upon even this in Grozny.
I don't know how old I was, maybe 5, 6, in my Soviet childhood. Stores were rooms with empty shelves. Here and there, a forgotten jar, a can of beans, a bottle. Grocery store, that was it. My sister and I used to spend the day with one of our aunts, Vera. And ever so often, Auntie Vera made our eyes sparkle. Today, we're going to make chicken broth. But the stores were empty. There were no ready-to-cook chickens. If, by magic, a chicken appeared in the kitchen, it was because someone, a peasant, gave it to you as a gift. Who knows why, maybe to pay you back or something. So Auntie Vera would take the chicken, pluck it, and pass it over the gas flame to clean it, because that would sear the chicken a bit. That's it. The smell of chicken over the fire. Burnt chicken flesh in Auntie Vera's kitchen. I smelled that odor there. And here it is again. Identical. Now, 40 years later, burnt flesh. Bodies blown up, burnt by explosives, by gas. Down there is what's left. While I stand, staring, paralyzed, I realize that today's Chechnya is also this. People burnt, like Auntie Vera's chicken.
Yellow lights, orange, green, blue. On the white floor, on the white of the floors where gold is reflected. Red carpets for the whole lobby, sofas for the patrons. Posters for the musical Northeast hanging in a showcase. Riddled with bullet holes. We are in front of each other, me and the terrorist leader. I know that behind that door, there are hundreds of people in the stalls. Their fate partly depends on me. The machine gun glued to his knee, he will never let go of it. And so seated, we speak. In the lobby of the Dubrovka Theater, on the floor, glass spreads out. Melted ice cream, raspberry color, sticks to the soles of your shoes. My name is Bakar, Abu Bakar. I am Anna Politkovskaya. Why did you agree to come? I don't know. I agreed, now I'm here, let's not waste time. Waste time on what? Negotiation. Are you here for that? Is there another reason? Let me be clear, we have 800 hostages in this theater. 41 of us are hostage takers. We all agree, we're ready to die. All right, tell me what you want. Maybe we don't want anything. Did you ever think of that? Only to show we exist, that Chechnya exists. Okay, but there are children outside. At least let them go. Why? You think Russian soldiers in Chechnya don't take it out on our kids too? Now we've got yours. This way, you'll learn. There are pregnant women. Let food be brought in. They've been locked up in there for days. Who cares? In Chechnya, people are starving to death. And that's not going to get you anywhere. Maybe not. Right now, people around the world are seeing 800 hostages in the Dubrovka theater on television. Nobody in the world gives a damn about us. They're killing us, and it has to stop. Who are you that you can pull off a kidnapping like this? A battalion of fighters for Chechnya. Guerrilla? Who do you think we are, beggars? I have a university degree. My wife is a doctor. Behind those balaclavas over there are teachers, engineers. And you all came here. Only the best. We handpicked them. We've been preparing for this for a year. How old are you? Between 20 and 30. But say I can get a truce. For what? Do you really believe that? Do you think they'll even listen to you? We only asked to see you because we know you're writing. But look, Polakovskaya, even only you can get so far. Russia needs our blood. Negotiating with them is bullshit. They'll attack us. Even if we free the hostages, they'll attack us. Okay, so what are you going to do? Blow ourselves up. We're loaded with explosives. As he says this, he lifts his camouflage jacket. He wears a high, thick belt full of electrical wires, ready to explode.
Old Shamsu in his woolen hat is looking for his grandson, Omar. He knocks at the office door. He addresses the official. Maybe you can help me? Hang on, old man. You have to fill out a form. There's a document for every missing person. Old Shamsu doesn't know how to write. Is there another way? The other man looks at him, then nods yes. We can come to an understanding. But first, there's a pretty dress for sale over there in the street market. Would you buy a pretty dress to get your grandson back? That's a good deal, eh? Shamsu runs out, gets the money together. In half an hour, the dress is hanging in the official's office. Where's my grandson? The other nods yes. We can come to an understanding, but first, it's so hot in here. I'd love a cool bath. Would you pay for a cool bath to get your grandson back? That's a good deal, eh? Well, Shamsi runs out, palms what he has. It's enough for a cool bath, which in Grozny is a fortune. Where's my grandson? The other nods, yes, we can come to an understanding. But first, I have a daughter in Moscow. She really wants a silk hat. Could you come up with a silk hat to get your grandson back? That's a good deal, eh? Well, Shamsu asks for the money all over town. The silk hat's already wrapped, tied with a bow. Come back to this office tomorrow. You'll find your grandson. The night passes in a flash. Old Shamsu is there early. He wants to be the first. He climbs the steps, goes to the end of the hallway, knocks on the door. Nobody answers. He knocks again. The door gives. The office is empty. What are you looking for in there, old man? There's nobody here anymore. They've all gone back to Moscow. Yesterday was the last day before their move. Here, take it. You have to fill out a form. There's a document for every missing person.
Even I have killed. Me. Anna. In the end, even I have blood on my hands. Here in Chechnya, there's no one who doesn't. I think about it often. How many people do I have on my conscience? It was 2001. I arrived at sunset in the mountain village of Dozin, looking for information on the looting that's hit all the little towns. I make inquiries, ask around, but no one talks to me. They avoid me. All at once, a mountaineer approaches me, tall, stocky, hard-faced, seems carved by an axe. His name is Vaha Kosuyev. He tells me he was once an elementary school teacher. Takes me toward a hovel. It looks like a stable or a goat barn, but instead, it's his house. We sit. Pours me a hot drink,
Then he looks at me and speaks. Someone else who agrees to talk to me is a middle-aged woman. Her name is Marca. She holds her son by the hand. They take me into a chicken coop. We'll talk there. They kill the family because they didn't have any beer in the fridge. I wave to the teacher mountaineer at the door of his hut. I wave to Marca and her son at the door of the chicken coop, and I promise them I'll publish it all. 2 days after the article comes out, an armored car stops in front of the hut. Are you Vakar Kozoyev, the one who talked to the journalist? There's no time, even for an answer. Gunfire, and gone. Are you Marca, the one who talked to the journalist? There's no time, even for an answer. Gunfire. She and her son stretched out on the ground. Dead because of me. My fault. People around me say that doesn't make sense. I'm not a Russian citizen, not you. Sure, but if they hadn't talked to me, they wouldn't be dead.
Where am I? Where do I find myself? Fog. I hear voices around me. I can't make them out. Not many. One, two. Sound of voices talking. All I have to do is open my eyes, and so I make an attempt. Nothing. Can't do it. I remain frozen, still, lying down, obviously. With the tip of my finger, I search the area. It's soft, fresh. I'd say it's a bed. What am I doing on a bed? Who's talking nearby? I hear my name, someone repeats it, but not shouting, no, in a gentle voice. Anna, can you hear me? Anna, all I have to do is open my eyes. Really, how hard could it be? I resolve, I try once more, tremendous exhaustion. I try hard. I half open them for a second, then the shutters come down. In that second, I saw that everything is white. A white ceiling, a white sheet, and whoever it is that's nearby is a white spot. I can hardly breathe. I feel my chest lift with the rhythm of my heart, rising, falling, rising and falling. Sometimes there's a little pause, tiny. Then it starts again, smooth and steady, rising, falling. I try to make an effort. I ask myself what I remember, the last thing, the last glimpse. I look inside among my memories, disordered drawers, and then again, fog. Only one image, here it is. A narrow place, everyone sitting in rows. What is it, a train, a bus? No, the small windows are round, an airplane. And now slowly, like when you develop a photograph by soaking it in a bath of acid, and gradually from nothing, the picture starts to form. It's me, running so I won't miss my flight, and four men grab my arm. Mrs. Politkovskaya, where are you going? Who are you? Security, what do you want from me? Where are you going? Osetia, Beslan, where the school where the siege is. Good, follow us. You're on a different flight. I climb aboard, I sit, breathless. I think, I'd like to sleep. I'm thirsty, I ask for tea. I remember the tray, hard, plastic. The tea burns a little, I have to blow on it. I drink, one sip and then another, looking around. Below us, Moscow disappears. I drink, the houses, the streets, the fields. I drink, then fog. I fall asleep, where do I go? And here, now, where am I? I dig deep, gather all my strength, push myself, come on, open your eyes, let's see. My chest pounds powerfully now. I press my forehead. My head is splitting. I nearly surrender. Then I open wide. The room is white. A hospital ward. The voices earlier were two nurses. One is thin, the other blonde, with two odd braids. They smile. One takes my pulse. Stay calm now. Everything is fine. Rest and you'll get back on your feet. Should I open the curtain? Want a bit of light? I indicate yes by lowering my chin. Then fatigue sweeps over me from deep inside like a wave. Before closing my eyes, as everything clouds over, I manage to ask through barely open lips. I was on a plane, and what happened? And the answer, with a smile, you were poisoned.
Down there in that school in Ossetia, in Beslan, you were there?
Tell us, who do you think is right, Mrs. Politkovskaya?
Taking a position is reasonable, don't you think?
Who's wrong, Mrs. Politkovskaya?
The Russians or the Chechens?
The army or the terrorists?
With respect to Beslan, which side are you on personally, Mrs. Politkovskaya?
Who do you support? Who do you condemn?
Who's mistaken, Mrs. Politkovskaya?
Who's in the right at Beslan? Surely you have an opinion.
In short, between two of them, which would you say?
Taking a position is reasonable.
Yes. I was at Beslan. A little while afterwards, I saw it myself. I saw a town of tombs, coffins, mass graves. I saw a school that was only glass shards, newly sharpened pencils on the ground, sketches with first day of school written on them, the torn bunting, the names of the classes, line notebooks, graph notepaper. I saw the bathrooms where blood spatter is still everywhere. I saw the imprint of dead bodies piled against the walls. I know that I walked in Beslan amongst the graves, singles, doubles, triples, quadruples, quintuples, sextuples. The names were carved in wood with the point of a screwdriver or on cardboard with a marker. You walk in between the rows, you read. On one side and on the other, you walk and you read.
Alexander Balandina, 9 years old.
Marina Petrova, 11 years old.
Kasan Rubayev, 14 years old.
Alina Tetova, 11 years old. Ira Tetova, 12 years old. Tiera Tetova, 10 years old.
Lana Tavatsieva, 9 years old.
Serman Vileva, 14 years old.
Madina Pukaeva, 12 years old.
Marzin Rushov, 9 years old. Alina Kubazieva, 11 years old.
Tamerlan Sharapov, 11 years old, 13 years old.
Lana Kazinova, 14 years old.
Olga Zadoeva, 14 years old. Anna Zadoeva, 11 years old. Larissa Zadoeva, 10 years old.
Madin Suzanova, 7 years old. Inga Suzanova, 9 years old. Boris Suzanov, 14 years old.
I should take a position, because taking a position is reasonable. Very well, let's see. Right. Will I support the heroin and marijuana fueled terrorists who took 1,127 hostages in a gym on the first day of school? Or on the other hand, will I support the army, which used a flamethrower against 10-year-old kids? I'd like to ask those reasonable people, does it ever say killed by the Russians? Or killed by the Chechens on the tombstone? Does it say killed by the army or killed by terrorists? I start walking again. Row two, the teachers, janitors, parents section.
Karina Adirkaeva, 39 years old.
Kazbek Konzev, 66 years old.
Timur Zalagov, 34 years old.
Zarima Lusmalovskaya, 39 years old. Killed for shielding her daughter with her own body.
I feel like throwing up. What do I do now? Do I keep going or run away, continue or shut my eyes? Taking a position is reasonable.
I never write commentary or speculation or opinion. I have always believed, and I continue to believe, that it is not up to us to make judgments. I am a journalist, not a court of law or a magistrate. I limit myself to reporting the facts. The facts as they stand, as they are. It seems like the easiest thing, but here it's the most difficult, and it exacts the highest.
what price? That you're no longer doing a job, you're fighting a war. You're at war. You feel embattled. And at 47 years old, I'm tired. Not frightened, not discouraged. Tired. Tired of reading every day in the political papers that I'm crazy. Politkovskaya, the schizophrenic. Politkovskaya, the paranoid. Tired of having to explain to my children that someone who tells the truth is crazy and someone who tells lies gets ahead. Tired of getting between 10 and 15 death threats a week. They show up on my computer, sometimes by phone. I'm tired of feeling like a criminal. Every 6 days, an article comes out and I am hauled before a judge among thieves, thugs. They're there for robbery, for theft, for rape. Me? For journalism. I know the hallways, the waiting rooms, the desks of the officials. I enter, sit. First question is always the same. Why have you written things that are not true? And who gave you this information? Questioning follows. 2 hours, three, why not even four? Sometimes they've detained me, sometimes arrested me. I'm tired of explaining to my children why I'm spending the night in jail. I'm tired of thinking of that freedom of information doesn't exist here. 90% of the journalists in Russia have a party membership. When you have a party affiliation, you're not a journalist, you're a spokesperson. It works like this. Press is divided into who is for Russia and who is not for Russia. If you are for Russia, after 5 or 6 years, they make you a party deputy. If you are not for Russia, you shouldn't be a journalist, period. Your work is propaganda against the state, period. Propaganda against the state is punished by death, period.
My son's voice sounds strange. He tries to hide it on the phone. I ask him, what have you been up to? He answers me 2 or 3 times, nothing. I told you, don't worry. When I'm away, far from Moscow, they always tell me, don't worry. Or when you come home, I'll tell you. This time, it's different. I just have to insist a little more than usual. They killed a woman this morning. There was a gunshot right here, downstairs. She was coming into our building to visit a friend on the first floor. She was blonde, about your height, your age, more or less. She was someone just like you. They said it was a robbery, but my son's voice stops. But, and I, over here in Europe, in my hotel room in Vienna, ask myself what it means. It takes me a while to understand, to put it together. The stutter in my son's voice. Downstairs, in my building, they have killed someone like me. Killed by mistake, because she looked like me. Because she was going into my building, blonde like me, tall like me, someone like me. It was my turn, but it happened to her. I've denounced, I've reported, I've questioned, I've demanded, but in the end, what good did it? Whoever made the mistake will sooner or later make it right. I know. Maybe tomorrow, maybe a month from now, maybe in hell. Who knows? Let's say, sooner or later. Sooner or later. Sooner or later.
Kolesnaya was found dead in the elevator of her building in Moscow on October 7th, 2006.
She had returned home after shopping for groceries. There were many heavy bags. She needed two trips to take them upstairs. First one was completed. Second remained unfinished. The bags overturned on the ground in blood.
They killed her with four bullets, one to the head. A pistol, a Markov PM, the weapon of choice for contract killers, is left beside the body along with four shell casings.
The police seized the journalist's computer and all material from her final investigation into torture in Chechnya. The investigation is supposed to go to the press in the next edition. Months later, it is still impounded, not publishable until a date to be determined.
The funeral takes place on October 10th at the Troyekurovsky Cemetery in Moscow. More than 1,000 people attend the ceremony, not one representative of the Russian government among them, no one from any official party, no one from their newspapers.
One of the highest ranking men of the establishment is asked the question, do you have any comment on the death of Anna Politkovskaya? He replies, sorry, I don't know who Anna Politkovskaya is.
This was truly an outstanding reading. Thanks to the play company, Kate and Melissa, and everybody. Again, this was written by Stefano Massini from Italy, directed by Lee Sunday Evans, translated by Paula Wing, who will join us also on the panel, stage managed by Jamie Van Dyke, and performed by Nadia Bowers, Sabrina Guevara, and Sakina Jeffrey. Thank you so much. So we will now have Valeria, Orani, Elena, and Kate with us for the shorter discussion, but for 15 minutes, because we have to get out, but in case you still have time to have some more insight into the play, please do stay. If not, if you have to go, it's absolutely understand, of course.
I'm Kate Lowald, and I'm the founding producer of the Play Company. And we have very little time. I think we have a hard out here at 9:30, so I'm going to try to...
We're 5 minutes over.
Okay, 5 minutes over. Good. I'll keep bargaining with you. We just have this wonderful group up here, and I'm going to try to ask at least one question and also save some time if you all have questions. Valeria, I would like to start with you. Valeria works with an organization here in New York, as Frank said, that creates sort of cultural bridges with Italy. And Valeria, if you would just talk a little bit about Stefano Massini and who he is as an artist in Italy and how this play fits into his work.
Stefano Massini, we met also here for the first time in New York with Frank at Italian Play Arts Project 2016, last year. He is an author and a director, and his work is grown up a lot in the last 10 years since he wrote this play. And then little by little he arrived to the direction of Ronconi, There was the best director in Italy since he died in 2015 with the Lehman Brothers, so the Lehman Trilogy. And now he is the director, the artistic director in the sense of artistic counselor of Teatro Piccolo di Milano, and also author, very acclaimed all over Europe. So his home play are translated and played in all Europe, in all the states of Europe, especially Lehman Trilogy again, that is directed this year by Sam Mendes at National Theatre. This play also was translated in many languages. And the main characteristic of the work of Stefano Massini as an author is he is a like documentarist poetry. So
documentary poetry. That's what
yes.
Said,
yeah. It is my opinion, but I can describe his work as a documentary poetry because also here in this play, he took some real documents and put together as fragments of. A broken glass and leave the shape of every piece of glass and give to the audience as a poetry. So I love this kind of work because it's very unique and I think his lucky star is also because it's unique.
Paula, you wrote the translation,
yes.
And I know that you're a writer and an actor also, and that your work is produced around Canada, but you wrote this translation, and I wondered if you could just tell us a little bit about what drew you to the play, and also if there were, because it's documentary poetry, let's say, what were some of the challenges for you? What did you think was important in the translation?
I agree with Valeria that documentary poetry was what really drew me to it. One of my close friends, who's also an artistic collaborator named Micheline Chevrier, was drawn to the play. She saw it in French in Montreal. And so when I was translating the play, I actually, I had the Italian and I also had the French because I read French too. So I had these two languages. So. As a friend of mine said, who called me when I was doing it, and he said, "How can you come out tonight?" And I said, "No, I'm translating tonight." And he said, "Ah, so you're looking up words like ah and the." And I said, "Pretty much." And I think the tricky thing is to maintain the integrity of that, the simplicity and the starkness of what Stefano writes, and that was the job of it. I really feel like I didn't. The title was the hardest. I think among translators, titles and swearing are kind of the hard things to do. And this title, the title in Italian is like something that would be stamped on a dossier. And I really, really worked at it, but the title, I always think, there's always that little thing where you don't, because it was like woman, unreeducatable is the literal, but not being able to be reeducated is hard to bring across the bridge to English. So for me, that was the hardest, and it still gives me a little pain in the kidney when I hear it, but there you go.
Okay, thank you. And Elena, I think everyone's bio is in the program, but just to say that you're an activist and a journalist from Russia, and I believe that you were a colleague of Anna's, and that she was an inspiration to you at the beginning of your career.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Would you share with us a little bit about that in terms of what her work meant to you and maybe what she was like as a colleague? I don't know what your working relationship was exactly, but.
Yeah, basically she changed my life because, I mean, I lived in Yaroslavl, it's a north town in Russia, and I was working in local newspaper, but I didn't took it serious really, but. And then I fortunately bought Novaya Gazeta and opened it on the page with her article about Chechenian children. And I still remember that article. And I don't know how to describe, like, I was shocked because I never ever thought that there is such kind of journalism. And I was always thinking that I like know what's going on in my country because I was watching TV, you know, and then I understand that I know nothing. So I decided to move to Moscow and to join the Nova Gazeta, and I did. And I mean, I do remember her, of course, everybody remembers her. Like, she was incredibly beautiful, like maybe one of the beautifulest people I ever met in my life. And like, she was working all the time. I mean, like, everybody is working, but she never had some time to chat with somebody, you know, to go to smoke together, kind of. I mean, and I do remember the line of people standing near her doors because everybody wanted to talk with her. Just people came to our office to meet her. And it was just a very usual thing. Like, then you, for example, enter to our news office lobby and you see the people, and people are asking, like, can we meet Anna? Like, how we can contact with her? We had some story. We have some son lost in Chechnya, killed in Chechnya, or we just have some crazy story and we're gonna share it exactly with her. So it was like that. Yeah. And so I joined Nova Gazeta in 2005. In April 2006, they took me as staff writer, and she was murdered in October 2006. And like, I never ever had a chance to tell her how important she was for me, because I was like too shy. I thought that when I become a good reporter, I will tell her, but you see. So, and like, till the time I never made the same mistake. I just want to tell that we lost like 3 more staff people after her, and we lost some people before her. So from time to time, they just murdered our journalists, so.
Yeah, I think certainly because we're working on this play, we're very focused on that right now. And are you based here now, or are you still, where are you
No,
based?
I'm here for a fellowship, so yeah. I'm based in Moscow. I'm just here studying.
Yeah. Is there anything that you can tell us about, do you feel the atmosphere has changed for journalists since Anna was with us, or do you think it's the same?
No, it's not the same. It's became worse and worse. So kind of.
Thank you. And Lee, thank you for directing this reading tonight. Thank you so much. And I know this was sort of one of your first opportunities to start exploring the play. And again, as documentary poetry, when you see this play on the page, it's just, it looks like poetry. The lines aren't assigned or anything like that. And so I would love to know what you're thinking about right now in terms of imagining staging the play.
So the play is a really interesting experiment in form, and on the first page, the writer says that it's a theatrical memo, which is an interesting way of describing it. And so I think there is something about the starkness of the language that's really exciting, because it's really putting you as the audience member like very close to her experience of not reading her journalism, which is also an incredible experience, but being with her as she lives through kind of these moments that became really key
key events that she covered and key moments, kind of understanding how she saw the larger context of what she was doing. So I think in this very, very early part of the process, the kind of big questions are how to use three women as the performers to not kind of fall into a more conventional idea of representation that we think of in the theater, of representing a character, but how to actually, in a way, be able to create a communal public experience where we're experiencing her language, but also to, in a way, be performing her absence, or be using three women to be creating something that can't actually be recreated. The text is all written in present tense, and she's describing what she's going through in present tense. But the play happened in the past, and I think a lot of people would come to it knowing that some of these things happened in the past. There's kind of an interesting haunting of the play in that way. And I think the other big question is, the text is so visual, and the images are so incredible, particularly to read on the page, what kind of visual text and physical text of what the actors are doing are you putting on stage in order to be able to provoke the audience to hear those images more acutely and more deeply and more viscerally. So I think those are the kind of like really key questions when thinking about how to put this on stage. And hearing it tonight was a really interesting experience of thinking about how to help transport the audience into that experience without creating a cinematic experience, but still creating a deeply aural experience. So those are some just kind of like the first initial questions about, I think, really exciting challenges of putting this play on stage.
Yeah, thank you. And the play company is producing this play. It'll be on in September, beginning September 10th. At the Mabu Mines Theater on First Avenue in the Performance Space New York building. So to find out how all of those ideas work out, come see it. Are we out of time? Do we have time for a question?
Maybe from the actors, I don't think we have a question, but maybe some of the actors would like to say something.
Oh.
No, but how does it feel?
I apologize for our mispronunciation, sorry.
No, I think then we will go ahead and close the evening. We have to be out here already. And maybe you join us at the reception. We will be at the Archive Bar on 36, between 5th and Madison on the south side, right in the middle if you have the time. And I would like to thank you all for coming, for staying so long, and for this beautiful reading and this incredible story Massimo put together. Okay?